Good morning. The meeting of the Accountability and Administrative Review Committee will begin as a subcommittee, essentially, until we get a quorum going. There are a number of hearings going on in the building today, appropriations on the Senate side, a number of other Senate committees for assembly members are going on, so you'll see members coming and going. But it's already well after 9 o'clock, so we're going to get started with today's hearing entitled Protecting Taxpayer Dollars Through Public Bidding. Today, the committee will hear testimony into abuse of competitive bidding in roof replacement projects for state facilities and public schools. The committee began looking into this area a few months back based on preliminary information suggesting a variety of abuses, including overcharging on public works through rigged bidding. Our ensuing investigation was statewide in scope. Scores of individuals were interviewed and thousands of pages related to public bidding and specifications were examined. Outside experts familiar with the complexities of public sector roofing were contacted. The committee's findings reveal a systematic breach of public trust. During these proceedings, witnesses will detail how millions of dollars have been wasted through unnecessary or costly roof replacement projects on public schools throughout California. You will hear how some consultants and manufacturers joined in a scam to accomplish this ripoff and how they contrived to line their own pockets at taxpayer expense. You will hear how the processes which govern public bidding and contracting have been subverted and manipulated. The state of California has nearly 10,000 K through 12 public schools, and a good deal of public money is spent to repair and replace roof systems, which represent one of the most expensive and obviously integral pieces of a school's physical infrastructure. It is unreasonable to expect that this much-needed initiative be undertaken with a minimum of waste and a maximum of efficiency. Again, we're talking about roofs here. It's not rocket science. And so we need to make sure that our bidding processes are as open and as competitive as possible. It is pretty clear from our investigation that that is not the case today. There are other systems that use closed bidding, using proprietary systems, et cetera, HVAC, and a number of other different aspects. But we decided to narrow it just on roofs because, again, it's a pretty apples-to-apples comparison under normal circumstances, and you will see how even something as generic as a roof can be manipulated in order to get a narrower competition going, which invariably costs more money when you have less people involved in the bidding. The findings of this hearing, as well as the reforms the committee will recommend at the conclusion of these hearings, should serve as a wake-up call to all of us. And we will continue to work not only in state government, but with local government and school districts to make sure that we come to some solution, some resolution of the scams that are taking place out throughout the state of California. So with that, wanted to let my Vice Chair speak.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Obviously, with scarce education dollars, laying off of teachers, the elimination of PE and art and other electives, laying off of librarians and counselors, it is absolutely critical that any misuse or misdirection of resources be closely scrutinized. And from all indications thus far, it seems that there is very significant reason for us to have a review of the bidding process used by the schools for roofing projects, and it sounds like it's not just limited to roofs, but there's a very good chance that it's with a lot of the contracting out that is done probably for air conditioning and heating, probably for carpeting and plumbing and painting and a variety of other needs as well, too. And I'm very hopeful that today's sunshine on this issue will help bring the changes necessary to provide the accountability and efficiency that's needed for our precious education dollars, and looking forward to hearing the testimony today from individuals. Thank you.
Thank you. And before I invite the first panel to come up, I also wanted to share a personal experience. Most of my colleagues know about my local government experience in Southgate, which was unique in terms of the corruption that was going on in that city for several years. And one of the tricks that the corrupt city council colleagues that I had used was closed bidding in terms of determining it was a sewer contract, and they narrowly defined what the project was and how it was to take place, that there was only one major bidder who came in, the one that they wanted in the first place. Well, eventually there was 34 felony counts by the U.S. attorney against our city treasurer, who was the ringleader for all of this stuff, and some of these things came out. So this is not something that I'm unfamiliar with in my experience. What surprised me here is how prevalent it is throughout the state of California. Our first panel will testify on a broad perspective of the issue before us today. The Little Hoover Commission issued a 2009 report that discussed the efficient and effective expenditure of school construction bonds. While their report did not specifically look at school roofing issues, they did look at whether there is proper oversight of school construction dollars. They have been asked to summarize their findings and recommendations, and we have with us today Carol DeLia, Deputy Director of the Little Hoover Commission. The state auditor has been invited to summarize a 2003 investigation they conducted into a roofing issue at the University of California, San Francisco. They have been asked to discuss that investigation because the committee believes the practices the auditor discovered then are being repeated throughout the state today. And with us today is Stephen Russo, Chief of Investigations at the California Bureau of State Audits. If you could come forward. Welcome.
Good morning. My name is Carol DeLia, and I'm the Deputy Executive Director of the Little Hoover Commission, the state's independent bipartisan panel that's charged with looking for economy and efficiency in government. Before I begin, I'd like to thank the chair and the vice chair, who also serves on the Little Hoover Commission, and the members, another member of which serves on the Little Hoover Commission. So we have a lot in common, and our commission applauds this committee for taking the time to look at this issue in particular. We have been asked to provide information from our work that we did last year, a study on bond oversight. Basically, what the commission was looking at, the voters had enacted a massive bond package, statewide bond package, in 2006, and our commissioners had some concerns as to whether or not there were adequate mechanisms in place to ensure that that money was going to be spent wisely and as the voters intended. Today, as your focus is on the local bonds and the school construction and renovation, I'm focusing just on a portion of that work where we also looked at what was going on at the local level. As we all know, Proposition 39, enacted by voters in 2000, reduced the threshold that enabled local districts to pass bonds for school construction and renovation, both community colleges and K through 12 schools. Many people found that this was a long overdue and necessary ballot measure that enabled school construction to take place and renovations that had long been overlooked. So not surprisingly, once the threshold was reduced, a lot more bond measures got passed locally. What went hand in hand with that was supposed to be greater oversight. And some of the measures that were included both in the bond measure or in the ballot measure, Prop 39, as well as companion legislation, put some things in place that on paper look like a really good idea. One of those was the local bond oversight committees that are required by the districts to establish. So effectively, we would have thousands of Californians all across the state working with the districts to make sure that money was being spent appropriately. Additionally, there were things included such as performance audits and financial audits, which local districts should be doing so that we would know if things were going awry. So those were kind of the mechanisms put in place, and I won't go into some of what happens when those oversight is lacking, because I think you're going to hear a lot of that from the people who will testify behind me. So I'll just kind of focus on what we found, what was good with the local oversight committees. Basically, again, having these thousands of people out there looking, when they're most effective is when they're independent, meaning that perhaps certain school districts, for example, will use civic groups, whether it's the chamber or League of Women Voters, to recommend members as opposed to having the district handpick them all. Also important is that these bond oversight committee members understand what their role is, that they have the authority to look at the performance audit, to look at the financial audit, and to question. A lot of cases, they simply aren't aware. Third, that the district provides them the support so that they can publish their public meeting notices, hold their public meetings, provide an opportunity for their annual required reports to be on the website so that the public can be informed as far as how the money's being spent. Ideally, they're more than just a check, you know, not a gotcha committee. Ideally, they would be able to work as a partner with the district to, you know, to catch things such as the bidding practices, which you'll hear about. Unfortunately, not all bond oversight committees are created equal. We found, not surprisingly, they're least effective when they don't know what their authority and role is. In worst cases, districts will actually write their bylaws and control what they can do and not tell them what freedom they have and what authority they have and what responsibility they have. They also sometimes fail to provide them with the support to hold their meetings. When we were doing our study, there's hundreds of these bond oversight committees, but finding them, it can be very challenging because we wanted to pursue it and talk to different committees. And, you know, the ones that we heard from were the ones that were able to tell us about some of the problems. And some of the people we heard from were actually being very proactive and trying to help educate some of the other committee members, both in their own committee as well as nearby districts. As I mentioned, the performance audits, that could be a very important component. And it's right now required by law, but we found what we were told was the districts simply aren't necessarily doing them. I was given a stack of audits that were supposed to fulfill this role, and I'm not an accountant, and I'm sure Steve will go into that area in greater detail, but they simply weren't the type of audit that was supposed to be conducted. And I don't know that it was something necessarily sinister on the part of the districts, as opposed to either not being aware, not understanding the difference, or not wanting to spend the money because a performance audit is going to cost more. But in the end, if it uncovers some of these things where money's being misspent or could be spent more wisely, it would save a lot of money. Unfortunately, at the local bond measure, this money is not just coming out of the local pockets, but I think most of the time, not in all cases, but in a majority of cases, it's matched with state bond money. So this is really a missed opportunity, if you will, to have these local committees really watching out for the public dollars, both the local and the state dollar. To kind of sum up what our commission found, we thought that there were some fairly simple recommendations, things that could be clarified in statute, and these things revolved around strengthening the local oversight committees, keyword being independent. We recommended that the state should require the local bond oversight committee that the district allow public input, community groups to suggest who should be part of it so that they're not simply controlled by the district officials. Training is the other key word, and our recommendation wasn't anything elaborate. It's, you know, very hard. These are people who are serving as volunteers. Hopefully they're selected because of their knowledge, perhaps because they have been in contracting, or they understand HVAC, or they're a roofer, and or they're an accountant, or maybe a combination of those different types of people, but that they're trained. And this could be in the form of, you know, something similar to the ethics training that we all do as Form 700 filers, where you just go online and it walks you through, and, you know, in an hour or so, you really learn what the rules are. And so they would know what their authority was, and they would know that they have the right and the responsibility to look at the performance audits and the financial audits, and that they can question them. Finally, we said that the performance audit should be further clarified in statute so that the purpose and the objectives are laid out and people would further understand them. People told us that it simply was unclear the way the statute was now. And finally, with those strengthened changes in place, the commission felt that the local districts should be held accountable. And if they don't do the performance audits and they don't follow through with the bond oversight committees, that there should be a hammer, and that hammer should be that they're not able in the future to use the lower threshold when they pass bond measures. With that, I'll conclude my testimony. Again, I applaud you for holding this hearing, and I'm more than happy to answer questions.
Thank you. Steve. Can you give us an overview of the analysis that you did in 2003?
Certainly. First off, I want to thank you all for the opportunity to provide this testimony regarding an investigation that we conducted into the issue of improper contracting, particularly at the University of California at San Francisco, where we received information that was that there was some improper contracting taking place. In 2003, the State Auditor's Office published a report of an investigation that we conducted at UC San Francisco. Our investigation found that UC San Francisco had unfairly restricted competition by several, in the course of several roofing contracts on campus, by using proprietary bidding specifications and other devices to unreasonably limit the persons who could bid on those projects and the materials that could be used to accomplish those projects. And due to these practices, we reached the conclusion that that there was an unnecessary inflation of the cost of the projects, although we weren't able to quantify that amount. As I'm sure you know at this point, state law generally requires that for public construction contracts to be awarded, they must be awarded through a competitive process. One of the hallmarks of a competitive process is that the process be established in a way that the specifications do not set barriers to the free and unrestricted ability of bidders to come forward and to provide responsible bids to provide those contracting services. In our investigation, we examined several roofing projects that were within one contract of approximately $500,000. We reviewed these projects with the assistance of a consultant, an independent roofing consultant that we hired for that purpose. We found that UCSF unfairly restricted who could bid on the projects by doing two things. First, they were requiring bidders to list three projects in which they had employed a similar type of roofing system within a 50-mile radius. Secondly, they required bidders to be manufacturer certified, or if they were not manufacturer certified, to hire the manufacturer's inspectors to perform technical inspections on the work that they performed. As to the first restriction, the 50-mile radius restriction, requiring documentation of doing similar work is certainly considered a standard practice in obtaining bids for work. However, imposing the 50-mile radius served no apparent use whatsoever except to restrict the number of people who could provide bids on these projects. Secondly, requiring bidders to be manufacturer certified or to hire the manufacturer's inspectors was to be an unnecessary restriction on the bidding process, in that there is no standard in the industry for what is required to become manufacturer certified. Each manufacturer sets his own standards for who to bestow this honor upon. And so, with no standard for who is manufacturer certified, requiring that folks be manufacturer certified provided no assurance that the work that was being performed was going to be at any higher standard than from other potential bidders. However, it did mean that if an individual was not a certified bidder or a certified manufacturer certified bidder, then that person would have to incur additional costs in order to accomplish the inspection requirements set forth in the specifications. What that effectively did is it took those people out of the running for bidding on these contracts, because they knew that they would have higher costs in having to provide and to accomplish the contracts by virtue of having to contract with these inspectors to provide the services, whereas the manufacturer certified bidders wouldn't have to undergo that cost. So what ends up happening, or what we found ended up happening, is that you have persons given an unfair advantage in the bidding process by virtue of having been certified for some on some basis by the manufacturer. In addition, in the course of our investigation, we found that by employing proprietary specifications for the materials that were to be used in fulfilling the contracts, UCSF unfairly restricted bidders in the materials that they could use and would prevent them from using what were potentially cheaper materials that were just as effective because they did not meet these particular specifications. We found that UCSF did this in two ways. First, they were requiring the manufacturer of the materials to be recognized in the moisture survey industry. The other restriction was requiring that the materials satisfy certain standards that were different from industry-wide standards, but could only be met by a single manufacturer. This was particularly noteworthy with regard to the roofing membrane requirements, where there were non-customary specifications that were established for bidders, and what we found was only a single manufacturer could meet those requirements. Requiring the roofing material manufacturer to be recognized in the moisture survey industry for the projects that we looked at was unnecessary in that these projects did not require moisture survey industry work. What we learned through our consultant was that this was something, a proprietary specification that had been promoted by three particular manufacturers who happened to have this recognition of moisture survey, of this recognition in the moisture survey industry, and therefore, if this specification was adopted, that is to say, you had to have this recognition, then it would effectively limit the bidders to those three manufacturers. In this particular case, none of the projects required that kind of expertise, so we found it to be an unnecessary restriction on bidding. In addition to that, we found that many materials requirements, particularly for the roofing membrane, were unnecessary or, in our consultant's view, had no rational basis and simply were a needless impediment to the open and free competition of the bidding process as it restricted the materials to a single manufacturer's product. A third thing that we noticed was the were restrictions that were existing in these bidding specifications on the ability of a contractor to use substitute materials that may have been cheaper or but still accomplished that were serviceable for the purpose for which you put the materials to use for. We found several devices that they used to put hurdles in place to prevent using substitute product. They provided by various specifications that that a contractor would have to provide additional material, additional information of an unspecified nature with no limit on it to UCSF at its request. It also required that any substitute products be manufactured using the same recipe, which essentially was, again, a way of saying you can't use a substitute product because there's only one product following a particular recipe. Or requiring testing for substitute products. And in some cases, this testing was not routinely done. So to use the substitute product, you would have to then, as the contractor, you would have to pay for testing on the substitute product that had not previously been done in order to meet these testing requirements. And finally, restrictions such as requiring that at the request of UCSF, a contractor would have to provide test results and pay for those test results, and again, with an open end, without a restriction on how much money that would cost to the bidder. With these restrictions, it was essentially discouraged in the strongest way possible that you would use any substitute materials, because if you attempted to use the substitute materials as the contractor, you were going to undergo unpredictable costs, which could essentially wipe out any profit that you might make on the arrangement. So, in summary, what we found was that UCSF had imposed bidding specifications that unfairly restricted competition. While we weren't able to quantify the extent to which these restrictions had inflated the costs of the projects that we looked at, it was reasonable to conclude that this certainly had an impact in that it prevented fair and open competition for the work that we examined. For its part, UCSF disagreed with our findings. They claimed that the bidding specifications were based on legitimate business need. However, they stated that they had begun preparing bids with the assistance of an independent roofing consultant to avoid the appearance of imposing improper proprietary specifications. That was their response. We stuck with our conclusions, and we have not been back to UCSF to see what their current practices are. So all I can give you is the picture that we found in this investigation.
Thank you very much. Any questions from members?
Are you familiar with whether or not any charges were brought, if there was any fraud or intentional mismanagement as a result of your study was brought to light?
No charges were brought that we were ever made aware of.
Okay.
Assemblymember Berryhill.
Yeah, this is how widespread is this? I mean, I think Ms. Strickland asked a very good question. There's got to be people that have been charged at this if this is widespread across the state. I mean, it seems to me there should be people in jail over this thing.
I understand your opinion. We looked at a particular instance where we were made aware of issues affecting contracting improprieties. We did not take this any further to see how further spread this was. But that's an interesting issue, certainly.
In your opinion, Carol, I mean, is this how widespread is this throughout the state of California? Because this seems to me a license to steal. If you end up with a couple people that are, they're not good folks, you're going to end up with all kinds of problems, or you could.
In our study, what we found is it's really hard to uncover. I think, as was mentioned in the introduction, you guys are focused on roofing today, but we also heard about HVAC, similar things. So I think my gut feeling is that it's probably widespread, but with the bond money just so dispersed over the state, it's really hard for any one organization, particularly at the state level. And I applaud the work that BSA has done here, but that's where these local groups really could be empowered to look more. But you're right, there's a lot of taxpayer dollars potential being wasted, and then it's harder to pass bonds in the future.
I find it very hard to believe that there hasn't been a whole bunch of lawsuits across the state, and this has got to seem a little bit like deja vu, Mr. Chairman, as you listen to all this stuff that's going on.
Thank you. Assemblymember Valines.
It was your report, I think, that mentioned that there's really not oversight around the state on how these things are happening on a project-by-project basis, right? So that's part
correct.
Of it. And then on yours, and this is a question out of ignorance, are you directed by the legislature to do all the investigations, I guess, for lack of a better word, that you do? Or could you say, there's a real problem here, we're going to extend this and go, I realize you have limited resources. So what's your authority on that? Are you able to say we're going to look further into this, or do you need direction from us to say let's continue to look even deeper throughout all UCs and throughout CSU or something like that?
Sure. The investigative function that we perform at the Bureau is primarily in response to whistleblower complaints. So we have So when we are given information regarding an improper governmental activity by a state agency or an employee, then we would look into that and we would launch an investigation into it. Additionally, we have the authority to engage in proactive investigations. That is to say, and in fact, we've done that in a couple of occasions where we found an improper conduct at one particular facility, at one particular agency, and then we took, based on that information, if we felt that the problem was further spread, that it carried over to other facilities, to other agencies, then we have launched investigations to look at whether or not the impropriety is occurring on a broader scale.
Then just as a follow-up, what made you decide to not go forward and look at others? I mean, or did you feel like what you looked into was enough and it really wasn't that credible? Or
that's just
you decide not to go look at more?
Sure, that's just a timing issue. This was done back in 2003, and the process of doing broader investigations is actually something relatively new to our office. We've just started doing that within the last couple of years. But it's certainly something that we can see the value to, and we want to do that more. Had this occurred more recently, you know, it's hard to predict what we would have done, but it's certainly something we would have looked at.
So we don't know that UCSF has made any changes, or if anybody has. Are they coming today?
No, they're not. Considering it was 2003, we decided, you know, to stick with things that are a little more current. And I would point out to my colleagues, tab A, B, and C in your packet has exhibits of current bid specs, 2010 bid specs. If you look in the box on the bottom of A, this document is from a 2010 high school re-roofing project. A single manufacturer is named as the acceptable manufacturer. The document includes the name and phone number of the company's sales rep. Public contract code section 3400 prohibits any public agency from calling for a specific brand unless the specification is followed by the words or equal, and that bidder, so that bidders may furnish an equal material. B, you can see here the bid specs very narrowly defined. It has percentages. It has very descriptive a layout. This is from a 2010 elementary school re-roofing project. By describing products and their ingredients in such detail, and by singling out one ASTM number, not a range, one number that only one product or maybe a couple of products could have met that target, only one roofing manufacturer in this case can be used. This document is from a 2010 California State University re-roofing project, Cal State project. Document singles out one manufacturer and places onerous requirements on a contractor wishing to provide an alternate product. This is the situation at UCSF. The contractor must submit his bid 14 days in advance. And remember, on RFPs, the windows are not that broad. They're not that long. And so they had 14 days in advance of other contractors to provide evidence that a lab had found that the replacement product could be equal to the specified product. So that effectively would eliminate their being able to participate because they'd have to turn their work in 14 days before in a narrow RFP window. So these are current examples, all three from 2010. I have a number of other, we didn't include these in the packet, but you can see here a number of other samples of current bid specs. A high school that uses a specific ASTM number to limit to one manufacturer. A university, hurdles to substitute products. Product descriptions that limit to one manufacturer, very detailed, full-page description of a product. An elementary school, hurdles to offering a substitute product. So we see this pattern of what was seen at UCSF, and we're going to hear from some of the people who are really out in the field on a day-to-day basis seeing this. Assemblywoman.
In your research into the UCSF issue, did you find out who it was? Was it someone at the university that was setting the standards, or where do you think the misdeed was occurring? Was someone from the private industry who was trying to do the bid inserting themselves into the process, or where did the manipulation occur?
What we found was that the way the specifications were being established was being influenced essentially by the expertise provided by folks in the industry. So we didn't go so far as to say, you know, whether there was some conspiracy afoot or anything of that nature. But what we do know is that when folks were writing, would write the specifications, they would be heavily influenced by the manufacturers, by folks in the industry to say that you need to write the specifications in this particular way, and that that would make its way into the bidding specifications itself. And whether it was because the folks writing the specifications didn't have the particular technical expertise to recognize when they were being led down a particular path to essentially only allow one supplier, one bidder, or whether they knew it, that's something that I can't tell you at this point.
Incredible.
All right. Thank you very much for coming forward and giving us the overview. Now we will have our next panel. We have Helene Hardy-Pierce, Vice President of Technical Services, Codes, and Industry Relations at GAF Materials Corporation; Carter Slusher, Senior Systems Engineer at Firestone Business Products; Mike Ducharme, Director of Product Marketing at Carlisle Syntech Roofing Materials; and Greg Malarkey, Senior Vice President of New Product Development at Malarkey Roofing Products. Helene, can you get us started?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Can you all hear me? Yes? Closer.
It's movable.
I'm an engineer. I should have figured that out as opposed to leaning over the table. Good morning. First, I want to thank you for the invitation to be able to speak today. Thank you to the committee, the chair, the vice chair. My name is Elaine Hardy-Pierce. As your chair indicated, I'm vice president at GAF Materials Corporation. A little bit about me. I have over 29 years in the roofing industry. I have started out as an engineer and spent 6 years in manufacturing, and then 23 years ago moved into technical support of products. I'm past president of the Single Ply Roofing Institute. I've served on the board of ASTM. I have been chairman of their finance and audit committee. I'm a fellow of the Roof Consultants Institute and also a fellow of ASTM. So just a little bit about me. I also prepared, and as I understand, Linda Morshed shared with you some prepared comments, and I won't read through them. A little bit about GAF, though. We are based in Wayne, New Jersey. However, we do have three manufacturing locations in the state of California. We also, in addition to that, employ a lot of technical and sales support here in the state of California. Our product line is very extensive, and so I don't have any. We GAF are not tied to any specific technology, from asphalt shingles to built-up roofing to modified bitumens, which is another type of membrane roofing, to thermoplastic TPO membranes and PVC, and then some of the restoration products that are available within our industry. And so it really, we can pretty much service when somebody writes a specification other than EPDM membranes. We have a product within that product category. Specific to proprietary specifications, I offered a whole bunch of statements, and some have already been discussed this morning, so I won't take your time to go back over them. But a proprietary spec is literally when you are limiting. And technically, we talk about limiting manufacturers, but the end result is you also limit bidders, because manufacturers have only a certain number of contractors that can bid their work. And that was discussed a little bit with the first people that spoke. But when we talk about how do they limit, they limit it within how they write the specification, which is your written contract document between the people doing the work and the property owner, in this case a school or public facility. And they limit it by doing arcane things. And I read these specs, and yes, I tend to think in black and white, but I read a spec that someone from our field or some, we have an architectural team that reads specs every single day, and they'll send them to me and say, Helene, it's a closed spec, and I'll read it and say, you're right, just move on. Because when I read it technically, there are even things that no one can meet. And yet they're so poorly written that the people who are writing the proprietary spec think that they can meet. And so that's a little bit of the theater of the absurd. But they do play games with ASTM specs, specifically within modified bitumens. There are different types. There's a manufacturer not with us today that was invited and would have been here except for a conflict. And their technical person, he and I, for over 20 years, have been arguing about, you know, this type of modified reinforcement or this type. You know what? We're both right, because both of those types of membranes provide roofing systems that work for 25 to 30 years. And I can take you to roofs that are not old, and so can he. And yet these games get played with ASTM specs by limiting the products. The one other thing that I'd like to address is when we talk about what type of money we're talking about, and then people will poo-poo it or they'll play it down. And I made two statements. The net penalty on a proprietary spec, in my mind, is 40 to 50%, the net penalty. Now, what do I mean by that? You may hear people tell you that, well, all of this other stuff is covered. They're easy to do business. They do this for us. Well, all of that other stuff, when I take that out and hire a roof consultant to do, or have an architect write the written specification and pay them, then if that wasn't there, the number is double. And so that's what I was trying to say. Hire an architect, hire a roof consultant to provide, you know, inspection services, pay for that, and you still are looking at saving 40 to 50% on these dollars that are being spent on proprietary specifications.
Okay, Mr. Chair, not to interrupt, but is that because they'll get involved and the specs won't be so goofy that nobody can meet them, and that's what adds the cost? Or why by hiring them will it be so much, you know, more affordable up front?
Oh, no. Let me clarify that. Oftentimes with a proprietary spec, the actual proprietary specification is written by a single manufacturer. Mm-hmm. And so there may not even be an architect involved. A true architect independently saying, this is a good membrane for this building, okay, and these needs for this building. Instead, they may have somebody stamp the plans and designs, but it certainly isn't independent. That architect is typically going to be at 5 to 7% of contract value. I'm saying you can take that 5 to 7% and hire your independent architect who has the best interest of the school or the public facility at heart, as opposed to a single manufacturer who maybe not doesn't necessarily have that.
They think they're saving money.
Because they make it easy.
Because they don't have the talent in-house, so they would have to pay, and school districts don't have a lot of funds. They can't use all of the funds that they've got available to them. So they say, all right, if we hire or if we have the manufacturer's person write the specs for us, then we're going to save money on that. And apparently, even after that cost is embedded, you're still costing 40 to 50% more on these projects because they're written in such a way that limits competition. Mm-hmm. No, they're paying a premium for that little bit of service that they're getting on the front end.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Finally, one other is that you were talking about this concept of being able to provide voluntary alternates. And our experience, and I think you'll hear a lot of testimony this morning, is that voluntary alternates, which say a roofing contractor who says, this is what was bid, but I'm going to just give you, here's another bid to look at, are routinely dismissed from consideration. Within the written specifications, you were hearing testimony about how they write out and how difficult it is for contractors. But there's also this path forward of using a voluntary alternate, and they're just routinely dismissed. I also, in my written comments, offered three different ideas that might be considered to look at preventing the use of proprietary specifications. Unless anyone has any questions.
Before we move on to the others, I want to address one issue of this hiring of consultants, architects, et cetera, to do the specs. In some of the research that the investigators did, for this hearing, we heard numerous times that school districts could not spend bond money for those services. We checked with Ledge Council and were told that, in fact, they could use bond money. Again, a lot of school districts, because of their financial condition, don't want to spend money on consultants out of their general fund or other funds. But we have an opinion from Ledge Council that says that they can spend bond money on this kind of preparatory work. So this misinformation that's out there is probably being promulgated by the folks who are going to them and saying, hey, look, you can't use bond money for this. We'll provide you the service, and then obviously lead them down that path. So I think it's an interesting lack of information that's out there that leads school districts and their lack of sophistication to figure this out.
Yeah, these isolated cases, or are we routinely across the state paying 40 and 50% more than we have to, in your opinion?
Is it 100% or 98%?
somewhere south of 98%, so you can sleep tonight. I did a scan. There's some construction bidding services that are available. One is Reed Construction Data. Another is Dodge McGraw-Hill Construction Data. Those are services that contractors use to understand what's on the street for bid. And I did a scan yesterday of what is bidding in the next 30 days using just two manufacturers that do a lot of proprietary type of specification within, and then looking at public numbers. And within the state of California, there was literally well in excess of 100 jobs bidding in the next 30 days using proprietary type of specifications within Division 7500, which is roofing. Because, you know, in architecture, you know, there may be some site work or window replacements. I was just looking at roofing, and then obviously with those manufacturers.
Okay, thank you very much. Carter?
Morning. I'm Carter Schlusher. I work for Firestone Building Products. I have 32 years of experience in the industry. I'm primarily a technical person, but I've served on the American Society for Testing and Materials subcommittees for years. And I think it's important to comment that those subcommittees generate the standards that Helene was speaking about, that define the products that we sell in the business. And to isolate one or two properties from those standards can easily rule any of us out of a specification. That's what these proprietary companies are reported to have done. We've seen evidence that that's exactly what they're doing. And, of course, the rest of us in an open, fair bid situation would provide information on all those properties. The other thing I wanted to say was we did some research lately about the jobs that have bid in the state of California. And these are specific jobs where Firestone has been directly involved with Brand X or Brand Y, who use these specification write-outs. The numbers indicate that the difference between a general spec and the proprietary spec is on the order of 60% in cash dollars. Now, these are jobs that actually went forward. These are not speculative numbers at all. And the average, the lowest number was $128,000, and the high number was over $500,000. And the average was around $250,000.
So in the survey that you conducted, projects that were done, there was a 60% overcharge on proprietary versus general specs.
That was the average.
60% average. Okay. And that dollar value was the range from 100-something thousand to over $500,000.
That's correct.
Just on one project. So how many did you look at?
We looked at a total of 40 projects, and those represent the first 6 months of this year.
40 projects in the first 6 months of this year, again, getting back to the fact that this is going on today in California, 40 projects, 60% overage, overcharging on those projects.
And just to give you a feel for where Firestone is in the state of California, we have two sales offices, and we're represented by roughly 80 licensed contractors all throughout the state. The high was just over $500,000.
So, I'm not doing math real quick, but it's not hard. That's a lot of money.
Well, your chairman said you have 10,000 schools, and I thought.
And that's the first.
Wow.
It's just on projects that you were a part of.
Yes.
In a given year, I know this is hard to say because you have really old schools and fairly new ones, but in a given year, what percentage of the schools need re-roofing?
We estimate 5%.
5% out of 10,000. 500.
500.
A year with 60% overage on some significant portion of those.
Yes.
Wow. Assemblymember Buchanan.
Are you saying this is incurring on every contract? I was on school board for 18 years, and I've seen what we're talking about today happen, and it happens sometimes very innocently, where someone comes in and convinces the director of maintenance or someone else that their product's the best product, it lasts longer and everything else, so all of a sudden that becomes the spec. And, you know, had situations where, no, we're not doing that, and you have to be sure that your contracts are written so you can have as like quality. But I think it might be a leap to assume that you're having that kind of problem on every roofing project.
That's not what I said. Right. I said some portion of the 500 a year would have this issue.
Right.
And clearly from the evidence that we've seen, just in 2010 specs, it is fairly prevalent.
Oh, I think it happens much more often. And I think it happens, like I said, sometimes somewhat, I don't say innocently, but people think they're doing the right thing for the school district or whatever it is. I mean, there's no intent. Someone convinces them that that's the best product, and you know it's not true. I mean, you can have light quality, but it happens, and the end result is that you do limit the bids, and it does cost school districts, or not just school districts, it could be any public entity, more money. I mean, part of my concern is how do we make sure that the bids are written properly so you have, people understand you can have products of like quality and still bid on the job, and that the bid specifications aren't so narrow that they effectively eliminate all the other products.
And that's where we're going to try to end up
right.
today. Were you done?
No, those pretty much conclude my comments, okay. Except that I support what Elaine said. He's right on target.
Thank you very much. Greg, can you follow up?
Hi, I'm Greg Malarkey. I've been with Malarkey Roofing Products my whole life. Sort of happens that way. We have a plant in Portland, Oregon, and a plant in the chairman's district in Southgate. I come at the world a little differently than Elaine and these gentlemen. In 1987, I became our sales manager, and we started to sell product into California. So I have a little over 20 years of sales management on the ground, running sales teams, writing specifications. And I can tell you that it has been my personal experience that these issues that you're talking about have been ongoing for that entire time. I can share with you that it's been my experience that they tend to be district by district. In other words, as a rule, a district tends to go down that path. It's not, as a rule, a little bit in this district and a little bit in this district and a little bit in this district. So, as a rule, a district will start putting those specifications out across the board. My experience is that the numbers that people are talking about are somewhat low I would say the numbers are closer to 100% more than competitive bids. My favorite story in this area was a specification that had ASTM is the material specifications that people write. This particular school district, this was several years ago, had a ASTM, and it drove us crazy trying to figure out what it was. It had been abandoned in something like 1923, and it was a rubber band test. So to meet the qualification for that specification, oh, by the way, we were included in the specification by name, but we couldn't meet the requirements, so we couldn't bid it. But it was the number of times that a rubber band in 1923 could be expanded and contracted, and that was then deemed an appropriate physical property for the roofing membrane. It took me 4 weeks to figure out that that test even existed. It had been discontinued in the 20s. It's not like it was published somewhere. And the equipment that was utilized to test that, I don't think it had been built since the 1914. So how do you even test that? Well, they had some ancient piece of equipment. That is not uncommon. I'm known for being somewhat outspoken within the industry. So I'll be more than happy to answer your questions. I've worked in your state. We employ in your state. More than half of our people are in your state. In 2006, we produced over 150 million square feet of commercial roofing for your state, and a substantial portion went to your tax dollars. So we're very well versed, and I would share with you that it is far more prevalent than you folks think, and it's a lot of money. And I will share with you that as a taxpayer through our organization, it's a real problem when we can't employ teachers because we're throwing money away on roofs. And even if they're roofing, which I'm not saying it is, even if someone else's roofing is better, do you really need a Cadillac or, no, strike that. Do you really need a Lamborghini? Wait, strike that. Do you need a space shuttle or do you need a roof? So,
Assemblywoman Buchanan.
And answering your question, shine some light.
Well, I'm going to ask it differently with all your years' experience, because I have seen, like I said, where particular manufacturers or people go and talk to the director of maintenance. I've seen it where architects or others write in their favorite product, and, you know, someone has to step up and say, no, you can't do that. I mean, someone in the district level has to make sure the bids are prepared properly. So how do we, I mean, there are times you do want a certain product or standard. I mean, and there are times you don't, but I don't. But, you know, I definitely believe that the bid should be written in such a way that they're legal, that you can have, like, quality, that, you know, you're not narrowing it to one product. So how do we ensure that that happens? Because I don't believe that most school board members, when they're approving the bid the documents to go to bid, or many others, necessarily even know that it's happening. So what's the best way do you believe to change the process to ensure that there's a fair bidding process and that we're getting best value for our dollar?
I think there's a number of areas that one needs to look to, and there are solutions. There are clearly solutions. I think that there are situations and times where you have conflicts of interest. For example, I'm aware, and I'll use something from out of the state, okay? This is from Seattle, Washington, okay? But I'll use it as an example. The fellow's a roof consultant, and he writes specifications for school districts. He also investigates roof claims. A disproportionate amount of those specifications that he writes tend to be supplied through one particular roofing distributor. and it tends to be installed by one particular roofing contractor, which he has a financial interest in both of those. So, and if the roof does go bad, he also represents the school. So he gets it a bunch of different ways. So disclosure of conflict and conflicting points of view, I think, is very important. I personally believe that there's a large portion of responsibility that needs to be played out. If you are somebody who has the responsibility to expend everybody's funds, and you don't know what you're doing, you need to be in a position that you can acquire the services of somebody who does not have ulterior motives. So, shining light. That's a big piece. That's a huge piece. There are a number of ways to write contracts and contracting documents to keep things open, but I think there has to be an understanding that we compete.
Every day.
Every day. Mm-hmm. I drive down the street and go, oh, they're the bad guys. but they're not, okay? And they make good product. And I'll share that we've manufactured for other folks who put wrappers on their products. So we're talking about roofing, folks. Love to tell you that it's rocket science, but it's roofing. And
it's true.
You know, he's got EPDM and he's got single plies and she's got single plies and all that, and it's just not that big a deal. You know.
So we're talking about roofing, but this could happen with your replacing windows, or if you're doing HVAC or mm-hmm. anything else.
And
so
I think that you've got.
The question is, I mean, certainly I think disclosure is important, but I also think it happens even on a more innocent basis when people don't have.
I would prefer the term benign.
Yeah, what?
I would prefer the term benign.
Benign, okay. You know, and so the interest is, I guess, is your solution just making sure that every contract has that light quality in it?
Absolutely.
How is your, I mean, what ultimately?
I don't believe that there's any school or office building, and watch me cut my throat, here we go. I don't believe there's a school or office building in the state of California that has a need for such a unique roofing system as to be, in some unique way, awesome. Mm-hmm. Not one. I can't think of a single school that has such a unique need that they have to absolutely have titanium roofing or something. But you're paying for it, and you're losing teachers because of it.
Mm-hmm. I was just going on with what Ms. McKenna was talking about. I'd make one clarification with you. I do think that anything on the Fresno State campus does need the Cadillac and all the other things. Outside of that, it's all the same. On the you talked about leadership that was on case. Well, you had something funny to say. Go for it.
No, I was just going to make the statement that, you know, it's one thing to spend the money to buy a Cadillac. It's quite another to spend the money for a Cadillac and get a Chevy.
Yeah, I like Chevy.
Well said.
I like Chevys too.
Yeah, I bet you have more than I do. The leadership issue you're talking about, you know, it tends to be district by district, I guess, and Joan, you would have the best experience at this. I mean, is there some kind, I mean, I don't, I'm just thinking out loud, but is there a process to educate those at districts? Because I know Clovis Unified, for example, I have no idea how this is happening at Clovis Unified. It's a big school district where our kids used to go to school. And they're very, you know, professional, buttoned down. It seems like everything goes smoothly there. But maybe at the very next district, it doesn't go well. You know, that so therein lies the problem. If you have certain districts that just don't know how to write these things or what to do, what kind of training happens for school districts and then board members who are? Because let's be fair, you know, to put the little blame on ourselves, not everybody reads a budget when they're voting on a budget in California either as a legislator. I'm sure they all do. Everyone in this room does. But some don't. And, I mean, not all
schools. Depends on how much time they give us.
Yeah, that's true. Well, you can get all summer right now.
Yeah.
But in do you know school board members have to approve those? Probably don't go through a process to really have to read those. And so I'm curious, trying to get to that leadership.
You know,
issue,
whether you're a school board member or a city council member, do they read every single bid document that goes out? No. Let's face it. To a large extent, you depend on staff to be trained, understand the laws. Mm-hmm. But even then, in school districts, you know, Fresno is a big district. It's one of the biggest in the state. There are districts that have 1,000 students, so you have differing levels of expertise. So you might be relying on consultants or architects or other people to help you prepare those documents. And I think there are some situations that are definitely intentional where they're trying to steer. I think it also happens, someone, like I said, you have a director of maintenance or somebody, and someone comes in, they go to lunch and convinces them that their product is the best product, it's going to last longer and everything else, and it's not being done for any kind of personal gain or anything. So, you know, but we need to be sure that the contracts are written regardless, you know, so that we are getting the best product at the best price. And that's why, you know, when you talked about disclosing conflicts, that to me would be a no-brainer. But then making sure, you know, the like quality. We've had that situation in my district where people wanted to buy a certain product and we'd have to say, wait a minute, we can't write it that way. We have to allow anyone who can provide like quality. But I'm sure where it happens, I agree with you, probably where it happens consistently, and in other districts it doesn't. And I'm not sure you would necessarily know as a school board member or a council member that it's happening.
If I'm right, I don't really believe that most people, and by most I mean 99.9%, get up in the morning and look in the mirror and say, that's a bad guy. And I don't believe that most, and the ones who do, I don't want to meet. But the ones who these are just folks trying to support their families. I mean, these are not, you know, and what happens is it's one step at a time, one little step at a time. And in and of itself, each individual step is not necessarily a problem, but the cumulative effect is. There's the fellow at the school district that reaches out for help. The next thing he knows, things are over this way. There's a guy who's trying to sell product and he sees an opportunity. You know, so I think that being clear that I'm not saying that there are bad people out there doing bad things. I'm saying that this is just one continuous process, and it's something that's not a new issue for you folks. And what I'll share with you is that your state has a huge issue with this as compared to other states. There are other states that really don't have as much of an issue. And I think you can speak to that. Yeah. So, but I would say I would strongly urge you to look at a statewide audit.
So why is that? I mean, if I'm a school board member, I'm hiring a roofing consultant and they're telling me this is the best product, it's the fewest defects, it's the last longer,
blah, blah. Best product.
I know, but I'm just telling you, they give you that information, you're going to assume that they're the expert and they're doing that. And so I still get back to a lot of it has got to be in terms of how the bid specifications are written, but mm-hmm. If you could elaborate why you think it's, is it more prevalent in California because we're a bigger market, or why do you believe it's more prevalent in California? What do other states do that we don't do?
Well, you've got a couple of suggestions on that, so I'll let you address that. Okay. And what I just finished my comment really fast, I'd say you really probably need to perform some form of an audit of your system. The easiest one I can think of would be something along the lines of take all the square footage and divide it. See what the average price is. And if somebody's coming in 5, 10, 20 times the average price, we might have an issue here. Doesn't mean that each project is not going to have an issue. There's some projects that are just more difficult. But, you know, but I think you guys need to sort of get to the bottom of what's going on in your system. But I'll turn that over.
Okay. Vice Chair.
Well, I mean, just listening to all this, I mean, either it seems out of ignorance of school officials or deliberate manipulation of the bidding process, that either way, it just seems criminal. I think that we need to, and hopefully can enlist your help, and whether through legislation or executive order or whether through a whistleblower hotline or whatever, as we're talking about laying off teachers and as we're talking about, you know, cutting art and PE and all of the electives, counselors and librarians, it's just unacceptable to allow this to continue. And so I would hope that I had seen, Helene, that you had offered some recommendations in your notes and yours as well too as we talk here. We really need to flesh this out because it just is not acceptable in any type of budget situation, not in good times, not in bad. And you know, we aren't experts in roofing. That's not what we do. You are. And so you can't expect a council member or you know, a school district official to be able to catch that, but you should have someone you should be able to call with that expertise. Perhaps that's someone at the state level with the Department of State Architects or with Department of General Services or someone, so that we do not continue to jeopardize the fiscal stability of our education funding. Thank you.
Assemblymember Pettis.
I just want to echo what our Assemblywoman, Ms. Strickland, had to mention. I agree with you 100%. And as a former school board member and being part of a $250 million bond and being the chair of that bond to make sure that we can build new schools or renovate our schools, I'll tell you, that was my first year as a board member and as well part of that oversight committee. I could have used some training. I could have used some education. Didn't have any of that. We definitely rely on our personnel from the school district, and we definitely rely on our, at that point, our facilities director. And so I noticed, you know, not to speak negatively about my district because I love my district, but I did notice some things along the way that just didn't make sense. But not having that knowledge or even what question to raise for that matter, and as well having an oversight committee that consists of community folk, but folk perhaps that doesn't come from that field or from the industry, we have a lot of trust as to our personnel and, quite frankly, at the end of the day, our facilities director and which way we should go. So on one end, I agree, Ms. Strickland, with your points. Something needs to come out of the state legislature. But I feel that on one end, there needs to be some sort of training, some sort of education of the oversight committees. And that obviously has a lot of implications there and other questions as well, even just time to do all that, especially if you have folks that are volunteering that, you know, want to do good by the district, but, you know, they're working folk, and it's the timing of it all may be difficult. But on the other end, how do we hold the facilities directors accountable? Because they, at the end of the day, are the ones that hold this responsibility that are negotiating or that are working with those folks that we're bringing into the district, whether it's manufacturing for roofing or whatever else that we need for our school districts. And so, you know, that becomes problematic because what I've also learned there is, you know, a director of facility may have 20, 25, 30 years within the district, quite a bit of experience and knowledge, but at the same, that could be a good thing, but that can also be a bad thing, right? Because on the other end, they may have all that expertise, but they also know how to work the system, right? On the other hand, you may decide to hire as a school district someone younger, maybe someone that perhaps fresh out of college or has some experience and can share some light and do some good work. But at the same time there, do they have an experience to do the job, right? And so quite a bit of concerns there, but ultimately, at least in my experience, I can tell you that it was very difficult to understand all this. And so on one end, how do we hold the facility directors accountable and school districts? And at the same time, how do we ensure that oversight committees have the education and the understanding and the skill set to do the good job?
Thank you. Assemblymember Huber.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I just, before this panel was excused, I wanted to kind of address one of the issues that Mr. Malarkey just brought up about how we should audit the system, and I'm going to take a position here that probably most people wouldn't take, which is I actually don't think that's the route we need to go. An audit, if we do an audit at this point, you're talking 6 months before we have a result. A bill doesn't get introduced until next year, which means it doesn't actually take effect till January of 2012. That is probably the slowest route we could take from this committee. We already have the Little Hoover Commission with their report about what we need to do with more training and doing more with the bond oversight. We already have an investigation from the Bureau of State Audits on one of the whistleblowers, and we're doing the investigative work right now in this committee. by bringing all of you folks in and all the work that the committee has already done to show that this is a prevalent enough problem that with just additional questioning from this committee and oversight from us, we could put something into place if we could work on it on a bipartisan basis on an urgency measure to start addressing this issue now instead of waiting until January of 2012 before anything would happen. Because we have a tendency in the legislature to find out about a problem and then study it to death before we do anything. And this, I just don't think we have any time to waste.
Ms. Huber, I offered that as a suggestion because that's generally the way these things go. But if you think you have enough data to go forward, I would encourage you to.
Thank you. We went a little far afield, but we still have one more panelist, Mike, to speak on this item.
Okay. I'm Mike Ducharme. I'm with Carlisle Construction Materials, and much like my compatriots, we supply a broad brush of commercial roofing products for the low-slope market. We supply EPDM, TPO, PVC, all Energy Star products approved for California, as well as insulation products. I'm also the chairman, of the EPDM Roofing Association, as well as a member of the Coalition for Procurement Reform, which is an organization that looks at how co-ops have been subverted by the same sort of proprietary approach. As a witness, over the long term to this effect, we've seen the dramatic growth in proprietary specs. Back in my previous life as a sales manager, I worked in the New Jersey market, so I was able to witness firsthand what occurred in New Jersey in the previous decade. I think that study indicated something like 55% of the roofs were found to be bid improperly, and the process was subverted.
Let me just interrupt for a second. On tab 3, we have other states' issues, including New Jersey, Massachusetts, and Minnesota, that have these problems as well.
Yeah, similar issues in all states. I would venture to say that in all 50 states, you're seeing it to some degree or another, but it's very prevalent, especially in public work. So I'm therefore appreciative of the opportunity to sit before you and provide testimony and talk about both the problems as well as potential solutions. Because we have spent a fair amount of time on the problems themselves, I'll just reiterate some of what the other manufacturers have mentioned. The three primary problems I see out in the market, first and foremost, is the writing of proprietary specs, whether it's written around performance criteria or around one manufacturer's name directly. It subverts the whole competitive process and definitely narrows the competitive process on bidding. The other element that is a major concern is the fact that in some cases, we talked about the facilities managers, that they have abdicated their role to the manufacturers themselves, letting them manage the assessment of their roofs, the budgeting of their roofs, the design of their roofs, and even the quality control during the installation of the roofs. Again, it's a competitive issue because if someone else wants to get in on that specification, they've got to appeal to a manufacturer for approval, which is highly unlikely. So that's another key element. Another key problem we've seen is the fact that the independence of the professional designer, the architect or consultant, has also been co-opted. In many cases, there's been remuneration directly to those specifiers, or in some cases, it's been indirect in that the manufacturers are writing the specifications and the specifier is rubber stamping them. So they're being paid for a service, but it's still not proper. So those are the three primary problems I see with the current process. Some of the solutions I'd like to touch on. We touched on the fact that the audit might not be necessary, and I think that's a very valid point because there is a focus on getting on with it, and I think that's a good thing. I think the only benefit to the audit could be that it would give us a benchmark with which to assess improvement. If we're correct, and we've heard numbers ranging anywhere from 50% increase in costs for these proprietary specs to as high as 100%. And I'd probably line up more with the 100% number in a lot of cases. It can be that egregious. I think it would be useful to at least have that benchmark to know where the current market is, the broad brush for the state of California. Maybe that's just a sampling. I don't know how extensive that needs to be, but I think that could be a useful process. Other recommendations would be I think we need to take some action to gain or ensure the independence of the specifiers for these projects. And I think that's not as hard as we make it sound. You know, it could be at the outset as simple as requiring specifiers to sign an affidavit that they've received no remuneration for their services, or that there are no cross relationships. They're not in the employ of that manufacturer. Make it a felony, where if they perjure themselves on that affidavit, you know, that they would be prosecuted. So I don't think that's as tough as we make it sound. As far as the specifications themselves, a lot of this is really just enforcing those elements that are already in place in the California bid statutes, things like having three manufacturers listed in the specs. If we would enforce that in a lot of cases just as a baseline, that would eliminate some of the gamesmanship that goes on. Shine the light on this situation. I think one way we could do this is to make more of this information available online. And this is more looking forward, not so much revisionist looking back at the jobs that have been bid, but as we move forward, let's have the specs and details for all school projects put online so everyone can see it, and let's have the results put online so everyone can see that. I think that would help improve the scrutiny. I like the suggestion for further education of school personnel. I think that's a great recommendation. Not very difficult to implement, and I think it would be key to just ensure that folks are educated in how the bid statutes work. Lastly, I would say, implement an anti-kickback law. I think that would be very effective in, again, constricting some of the games that go on and put some real meat behind the penalties. So, just some recommendations.
Anti-kickback from who to who?
It would be from the state to the specifier if they've accepted any remuneration for writing a proprietary spec.
Okay.
Not
in the investigation that has been done, I want to make a couple of things clear. One, the sampler that I cited earlier of specs was all over the state, Southern California, Central Valley, Bay Area, the only area that wasn't the Sacramento area, the only area that wasn't represented was the far north, just because it's not as populous. But the rest of the state is well represented in those specs. So in terms of geographic distribution, it's happening everywhere. Again, not everywhere all the time, but it is happening everywhere. In terms of the recommendations that you've given, I appreciate all of the input that we've been given here today. We will, I think, incorporate. We have some recommendations that our staff has put together, but we will maybe consolidate everything that you've given us, and we'll have a further discussion at a later date about the recommendations you've given us as opposed to what we have done together. I wanted to ask Helene, ASTM comes up frequently in these bid specs, where the spec will ask for a specific ASTM number, not a range, not a minimum, but a specific number. Can you tell us what the meaning of that is?
I'd be more than happy to. The way that ASTM standards for roofing work is that there are two types of standards. You have a testing standard that says you need to chew it up and spit it out, and this is just, we're going to pull it this way or we're going to heat it this way. That's a test standard. Typically for modified bitumens, modifieds as one product category, they have their own test standard, which is D5147. There is a test standard for load strain properties. There's a test standard for asphalt shingles. There's another one for asphaltic type rolls. So those are test standards. When we start talking about product standards, they are specific to a product. Now, such as TPO, which are white thermoplastic membranes, they have a standard that's different from PVC. Now, there may be a very valid reason why an architect wants to use PVC or TPO, and there is a specific standard. Within the standard, and this is where the games get played, there are types and grades within the standard. And that gets to what Greg was alluding to and Carter, and it's not rocket science. I alluded to it earlier. Within modifieds, there are three standards for a type of modifier used in asphalt, SBS. There are three standards, and it's by reinforcement. So there's fiberglass reinforcement, there's polyester, and there's fiberglass-polyester combination. What I was saying earlier, there's another manufacturer, and their whole philosophy has been based upon fiberglass reinforcement, and their roofs work. And they work a long time, whereas I tend to like polyester, and I like it for other reasons than my compatriot. His name is Tim. And Tim and I, we joke and we argue, but so there's two different standards. They both are representing a class of SBS modified products, and they both work. So, yes, there can be different standards, but even within now, let's go to the fiberglass standard. Within that standard, one of the games that's played is there are three different types. Type 1 has a low tensile strength. Type 2 is a little bit higher. It's kind of what I consider the premium product. And then there's this space shuttle that is really, really high. Well, in building sciences, which I fall back, but in building sciences, the roof's not meant to hold the building together. Even here in California where you all have earthquakes, okay? The roof's not meant to hold it together. But those people that want to say the best stuff is really strong, that's what they're selling people on. But I'll tell you right now, that type the type one within that standard lasts 20 years when it's put down in two plies every single day. And so that's some of the things that are played with within the standards. Does that explain or answer your question?
I was getting to the issue of having, you know, a specific standard laid out in a spec everybody's going to meet that standard. Only one person, one product could meet that standard as it's defined that narrowly. Now, if you gave a range, then you would be able to get a number of different folks. It's like saying everyone in this room who is 6'5 and has brown hair, you know, you're narrowing it to such an extent that you're only going to get one entity that's going to hit that target.
Right. And that's exactly what they do by using, like in the example I use for this one type of product, using a type 3.
Yeah.
The easiest way to see a pragmatic approach to specifications is if we just stick with modifieds because they're easy. With modifieds, you'll see a savvy roof consultant or architect oftentimes will use, okay, you can use this or this, different types of reinforcement, because they know that they both work. When you get into the single-ply membranes, those types of games aren't played necessarily as much. But, Mike, you would agree, yeah. I would think, with that. It is a TPO is a TPO. It's there, and those products are more delineated on thickness. Mm-hmm. And so they'll just say it has to be a minimum of 60 mils as opposed to 45. Right. And so that's how they'll delineate within those products.
Assemblymember Huber.
I just want to be careful of another issue that I think we're not talking about here, because we're kind of assuming all roofs are the same. I live in El Dorado County, where all the roofs for school buildings have to meet snow standards, right, which means we have all pitched, all metal. And Amador County has the same thing, even though it barely snows there. So I'm trying to be careful as we're crafting solutions to this to make sure that we're not inadvertently overrunning local building codes for different weathering conditions in, like, snow country. And if you could just address a little bit how we can be sure that we kind of avoid that problem.
I think by using your state architect's office, you have the state architect's office, you also have the building code, and you've made a very, very valid point. This state, more so than any other state in the country, you have everything. You know, in Southern California, the roofing joke is that a roof in Southern California provides shade, because it really doesn't rain a lot there. I mean, so you're not trying to keep a whole bunch of water out. But you go up into the mountainous regions, or out in the Bay Area where the fog every single day rolls in, and so you have rainforest, you have desert, so you have the complete gamut, and you have the complete gamut from roofing needs. In Southern California, what they call a roof in some other parts of California, you don't want that roof because it won't perform. So to your point, and I think that's where there's been some discussion about the state architects, and that's where your design professionals get away from this one-size-fits-all mentality, which is certainly inappropriate for roofing.
Thank you all very much. We have one other panel that we want to bring up, but thank you so much for coming forward. Really appreciate it. Our second panel consists of three people, Don Lambrick from Don Lambrick & Associates, Gary Reeves from Western States Roofing Systems, and Brian Chalesky from Skyline Engineering Incorporated. We'll start with Brian.
Good morning.
Morning.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you. I am president and owner of Skyline Engineering, which is a engineering company that specializes in design and consulting services for roof replacement. We are an independent company. The people that you were talking with before are competitors of the manufacturer's reps that you were talking about, but I'm not a competitor. I'm an independent engineer. My company works with about 10 different school districts in the Bay Area. Over the last 12 years, we've worked with probably over 20 school districts, so we have a real good feel for the bidding process and some of the things that are going on. I was invited to testify this morning because of my experience with some of these districts and the proprietary specifications. Basically, the bottom line is that sales reps are writing specifications. And to me, that seems ridiculous. Engineers and architects should be writing specifications. The state of California does not require an engineer's or architect's stamp on a roofing specification. Anybody can write a spec. Only if there's structural work that needs to be done on a roof does that roof need to go through the Department of State Architect. Many other states in our union have a requirement that an engineer or an architect needs to be involved with the roofing specification. And getting on the solution side really quickly, that would solve an awful lot of the problem that we're seeing here, is having an independent engineer or architect or roof consultant involved, and it's been noted before. I've got some examples with real numbers. Would you guys like to hear some real number examples? A school district recently went out to bid with one of these proprietary specifications. They held the pre-bid meeting. Contractor showed up, looked at the roof. Then, within the internal structure of the district, one of the managers took the responsibility of that roofing project away from the maintenance department and gave it to the facilities department. So a different group of people now were running this project. But the bids had not opened. They had walked the roof. They had performed the bid walk, but they had not opened the bids. Immediately, the facilities director recognized that this was a proprietary specification. He hired our firm to take that specification and open it up to at least two other manufacturers, which I did. We opened it up to two manufacturers that, in my engineering experience and expertise, were actually better than the existing specification. But we included, we kept that same manufacturer, so we had three total. We listed three companies and or equal. That was put out as an addendum to the specifications, and immediately contractors started to give us feedback and input. They were reducing their price by $200,000, and this was on a project that ultimately bid at $500,000. That's one example. My next example is actually, go ahead.
sorry to interrupt, yep, but just it's easier to ask as you go along.
Absolutely.
So in that case, somebody said, instead of it being, hey, this is our bid and we're going to be good to go because we meet the specs, now there's three people involved and we better get our pencil sharpened and be competitive.
That was part of it. The other part of it was that the proprietary specification, which was written by the sales rep, mm-hmm, was the only manufacturer to meet that spec.
Right.
Therefore, could charge anything he wanted for that product.
So somebody felt they could charge whatever they wanted.
Yeah.
They knew they'd meet it. Once you changed it to be open, including the one, but to all three,
yes,
they quickly realized they're going to be way over, yes, the bid price and not get picked.
So now the low bidder actually is going to use a substitute. So he's not going to use any of the three I listed. He used a substitute. So I had to do an analysis of that recommended substitute to make sure that it was equal to the three that were listed. In this case, it was standing seam metal roofing, and standing seam metal roofing is pretty straightforward as far as an analysis. You don't have the tensile strengths and all that kind of stuff to look at. But $200,000. Now, how can you verify that number? You'd have to verify that number by actually talking to the contractors that bid the project. You'd have to talk to the actual contractor, and he'd give you information as to what kind of pricing structures these manufacturers were giving him. The other two examples I have are easily verifiable, just simple open public record. Another school district, we bid with an open spec, and the numbers came in at just under $8 per square foot. At the very same time, another school within the same district bid using one of these proprietary specifications, nearly $15 per square foot. Now, the two schools weren't that different. They weren't that different in location. They weren't that different in configuration. In fact, the lower price school had some features that would have made it more expensive, of like a concrete deck that you had to use additional adhesives, had some tapered insulation. So the comparison is even skewed the other direction. So we're talking less than $8 a square foot versus nearly $15 a square foot. And that's verifiable. You can get that information. The third example that I have is also verifiable. A project that in 2008 was bid with a proprietary specification. Bid numbers came in at $18.94 a square foot. That's high, but it was a full tapered system. It was a full tapered system over a metal deck, lots of adhesives, lots of tapered insulation, very difficult project. $18.94 a square foot. The district could not handle that number. The following year, we went in and we added two names, just like we did in the first example. We added two names to the specifications, added manufacturers. Bids came in at $10.30 a square foot, saving the district almost $230,000, which these numbers are approaching that 100% figure that some of the people were talking about earlier. So those are verifiable, and I didn't scour the earth to get these districts. These are just three districts off the top of my head that we're working with that are moving from the proprietary specification to an independent engineer, in the case of using us. Why do districts use sales reps to write specs? In the 1990s, I was a sales rep for 10 years, and I did that. I wrote specifications for my clients. Why do they do that? It's easy. Districts, in order to find an architect or an engineer, have to perform an RFQ process where they advertise, they interview, they look at resumes. It's a process that may take a month to do. Oftentimes, districts are behind in schedule. They need to get their roofs out. They need to spend the money. Summer is very short. They got to get the roofs on. Much easier to take a specification provided by a sales rep and just go with it. So there's ease. I also think that some of the districts, the facilities directors that we're talking about, they're fooled. They truly believe that this more expensive roofing system is that much better. Again, coming from a totally non-biased engineering standpoint, that's just not verifiable. They have not verified that a more expensive roofing system will last longer. It just isn't the case.
Do you know, when you were brought in to do your consulting services,
yeah.
Do you know, I mean, I don't know if you can know this, but were you paid through bond funds to do this?
That's a good question. In fact, I don't know. I wrote that down in my notes. I'm going to talk to some of the districts to find out if that's the case.
Because I do know, as the chair had mentioned, I've heard school districts say there's so many things that we can't use the bond funds for. Our hands are tied. It sounds like that may not
be I've not heard that. I've not heard that. But, earlier we're talking about Cadillacs. When we did this to that school district where we changed the spec and saved them $200,000, wow, the emails that flew around from the sales reps. And the sales rep actually said, you know, if you guys don't want a Hummer, great, you want a Hyundai, that's fine. And the facilities director and I we paused and we kind of laughed at that. Hummer. I mean, what would happen if a school district bought Hummers for their maintenance guys to drive around the community? There would be outcry. Hummer? Hyundai is an excellent company. Don't they have the 100,000-mile warranty at Hyundai, and they have an excellent track record, and they're performing extremely well, and a Hummer is not. So it was kind of ironic that the actual sales rep used that comparison, which is a very good comparison, not Cadillac, because Cadillac is quality. Not Rolls-Royce, because Rolls-Royce is elegance and quality, but a Hummer, which is very expensive and totally unnecessary.
Thank you very much, Gary. And we're not promoting or denigrating any auto manufacturer. We're talking about roofs today.
But people from Hummer, I think they're out of business, aren't they?
Hi, my name is Gary Reeves. I'm with Western States Roof Systems in Los Angeles area. And proprietary specs are at least 80% of the work down there. It's proprietary. And I am approved by the biggest part of the major contract manufacturers out there. And I do bid the proprietary specs. And basically what the people here are saying that, you're paying 50, 60% more for a roof system than you should.
Thank you very much. Don.
Thank you for having me here today. My name is Don Lambrecht. I'm the owner of Don Lambrecht & Associates, and I'm one of these product reps. I'm also the past president of Construction Specifications Institute, who is the group that actually laid out the format for specifications, and I'm also a member of RCI, which is a Roof Consultants Institute. And as you can see, I'm also old, so I've been around in the roofing business for a long time. I started to come in with the saying, mad as hell, and I won't take it anymore. And, you know, quite honestly, the reason I'm part of this program right now is I am mad as hell. I'm a California native. I grew up here, the third generation. I've watched this school overcharging for years and years and years. As we talked before this meeting, I shared some of the letters that I've written to school boards and to facility managers over the years, reminding them that there are California statutes that they're supposed to be equal, and that the statute basically says it needs to be equal in form and function. That doesn't happen. The arguments I get back, and I would love to share the letters with you, are just downright rude to the point that they dare you to sue them. So you ask, you know, why doesn't somebody turn in all of these people? I'd love to turn in all of these people. Who do I turn them into? I don't know. I've been at this a long time. You know, what is the number? Do I call the attorney general? Is he going to go after it? Who in the world is responsible for monitoring this? And something has to be done to give us an outlet to be able to go in there and monitor these specifications. I believe, Michael, you are Clovis. I was going to bring an example of a single source spec and guess the one that I picked out. I didn't realize you were here. I just happened to bring the Buchanan High School Performing Arts Center out, and it happened. Oh, okay. That happens to be a very egregious single source spec that did just bid to the tune of $3 million for the entire project. I would wager if you want to go back through and find some examples of overcharging, you probably find one in your district. And I didn't set this up, I promise.
What do you think that was over? I mean, what percentage do you think that was over? Is that approaching maybe 100% in your opinion? Is that a 50%? That seems awfully high.
I would say it's probably somewhere between 50 and 100%. In that there are no other, there are two products named. Both of them happen to be products that we've talked about. So, I would say it's extremely high. You know, a roofing contractor, we talked about, I think there was a comment whether, why people don't come forward, why these aren't being prosecuted. And it is very difficult to prove this. But, you know, subpoenas to some of the contractors that do this work will tell you exactly what's going on. Or, for that matter, private conversations with the contractors. It's very difficult for a contractor that has worked with some of these manufacturers on single source specs to be vocal about being against them. What happens is they're shut out of the bidding process. We all know the condition of the industry right now in the construction business. You can't afford to be shut out of anything. You can't expect the guy to voluntarily come out there and tell you that he knows that he's overcharging the district or the state for products he's doing. He'll be cut out of the business, and you can't afford that right now, and I'm sure you chuckled at it. It's very common knowledge in our industry. Yes, you may not see it. We deal with it every single day of the week. The people that are involved with doing this sort of thing are just egregious. I mean, it's to the point where it's unbelievable.
Yes. Not just in the Clovis example, but in the others like you talk about, just in the industry, when we're talking about overcharging, it's not actually somebody sitting down and saying, I'm just going to jack up my prices by 40%. You're actually, what I'm hearing a lot is that it's somebody getting a product that could easily be bought equal to for less. Is that right? I mean, so
I'd say it's about half of that.
So it's both.
It's both. If you have a proprietary specification, one or two brands out there, let's say if you have an opportunity to bid a job and you don't have a lot of competition, you probably are not going to sharpen your numbers, as we call it, which means you're probably going to upcharge for the labor and the installation, along with the higher cost of the material. So yeah, maybe it's half and half, but in both cases it's going to be very, very high. I've been in California state jobs, a Board of Equalization job, that I went into a pre-bid walk. The individual who actually happened to be a state architect was the guy running the job. And he had a proprietary spec, and I went in on purpose to break the specification, to open it up to everybody. And quite honestly, it had nothing to do with any material I was selling. This is how far I've gone before. I don't care if it's my product or not. I don't like proprietary specification. And I was quickly chagrined to find out that the architect from the state of California who had to have this product had absolutely no idea what he was specifying. In one case, they talked about a warranty, and they had a 30-year warranty. And I asked him if that warranty was good for the entire 30 years, and he said, yeah. And fortunately, the product rep for that particular brand, and I'm surprised, he opened his mouth and says, well, no, it's actually a 10-year warranty, and it has to be renewed every 5 years for the full 30-year term. Now, to renew a warranty every 5 years means they have to basically redo the roof every 5 years. It was a great deal, and the roof needed to meet energy California cool roof requirements. It didn't. So the cost was going to be double of everything in the world, and then it had to be recoded after the bid to meet California cool roof requirements. This is what goes on. It's pathetic.
I appreciate your honesty and your testimony.
Yeah, I know.
Well, it seems like you've been out there for a while, so I'm not too concerned about where you're at, and I very much appreciate you taking it upon yourself to challenge these things. But clearly, the testimony that we've gotten from the previous panel and this panel is that this is very prevalent up and down the state. 80% in Southern California.
Before I came here. I took 10 minutes, went on the internet, pulled down specifications, and out of 10 of them, 7 of them are proprietary specs.
7 out of 10 in Southern California.
Yes.
So if that's what we're talking about, just even at a 50% number of the 500 or so that happen a year, so that's 250 a year. And the range we were talking about in terms of the dollar amounts was $100,000 to over $500,000 per project. You're talking about $30 to $125 million a year.
That's just in roofing.
That's just in roofing, yes. Just in roofing. $32 to $125 million a year if half, and you cited 70%, but if half of the projects, proprietary projects are out there, are proprietary, are closed, and therefore cost us more money. We did a handout that is on every member's desk, a comparison of costs using proprietary specs versus open specs. The top box, and you don't have this, but the top box shows 3 proprietary specs, different sizes of projects, one 400 square feet, one 285 square feet, another 1,500 square feet range. This is on the proprietary specs. $14.62 on one per square foot, $12.90 per square foot, and $9.76 per square foot. On open specs, similar sizes, 450 square feet, 350 square feet, 400 square feet, and 1,000 plus square feet. The prices per square foot, $777, $657, $792, and $6. Not one over $8 per square foot. That's what we're talking about here. And obviously, these dollars add up. I have a number of other questions. I know we've focused on roofing, but other closed spec systems that I've been made aware of are things like fire alarm systems, security systems, telephone systems, HVAC, we've alluded to numerous times today, IT systems are written in such a way that only one manufacturer can deliver. I know we're talking about roofing. Have you had any experience in any of these other areas, these other products, systems?
We have a little bit with mechanical because we're a mechanical engineering company, and there are a lot of issues concerning matching that go on with mechanical units. For instance, if you're going to replace HVAC package units at a school, maybe only the package units need to be replaced, but the control systems don't. And so if you have train before, you need train again. So there are a lot more issues with matching with HVAC than there are with roofing. It's a rare instance where you need to match a roof unless you're doing repairs.
Okay. One of the experiences that I had as a city council member was on leaseback, and I don't know if this happens in roofing, probably doesn't, because you buy the roof outright. But we had an energy system contract during, again, those bad years where we had the corruption going on, where the way they got around all of this was there was a company that had energy systems that they offered to reduce the city's energy consumption. And they that company would loan the city money to do all of these upgrades, these energy efficiency upgrades. And the city would continue to pay the same amount that their energy bill, their total energy bill was over the last year, and continue to pay it for, I forget what the time frame was, 5 or 10 years. And the delta between the energy, that cost, and the new energy bills, the savings, would go to pay off the loan. That was the deal. And so for 5 or 10 years, the city continued to pay exactly the same amount that they paid for the year previous on their energy bills. And allegedly the difference was going to pay off for the loan that the city got. Well, what was the deal included? You had to hire this company. You weren't getting a loan for free. You were getting a loan to hire them to have them do this energy efficiency work. Is there anything like that that goes on in roofing or in any of these other areas?
The closest
areas
thing I'm aware of is one of the manufacturers has a program by which you can purchase a service contract where they'll revisit the roof every 6 months or every year for a fee, of course, an upfront fee, and clean the drains, do any preventive maintenance and such. And what that enables the building owners to do is capitalize those maintenance costs up front into a project. A lot of school districts and state universities just don't have the personnel to do that kind of work. And so this is rolled into the roofing system. So,
and
of
with,
course,
with
if there's any
like
problems,
that.
Of course, if there's any problems with the roof, those problems are taken care of by the manufacturer using his workmen at the expense of the district or the university.
So they would bill them,
yeah, and
for that service.
And most often those bills are paid up front within the cost of replacing the roof. Up front. So they've already paid for them.
And would that be part of the bid specs too?
Yes.
That there would be this service contract that only one manufacturer offered?
Correct.
Okay.
You have to be very careful in this. This does happen, and of course schools are the prime target for this type of thing, but on the other side there are ways of negotiating in your contract that the roofing contractor also service the roof yearly, not being paid up front but being paid generally a set fee. So you can work at both directions, but the ones that you're paying up front are egregious. And ironically, I mean, I think all of you guys realize that a facilities manager is working there today, and your roof's warranted for 20 years, the chances of him being there in 20 years are probably nil, which means that you've paid all this money up front. 2, 3, 4 years, this manufacturer's individual, who you hope keeps working for the company, comes out there and does his job, and then somebody changes place and nothing is done. I've seen this in districts.
And one of the districts that has been wanting to move away from the manufacturer and is using our firm, this is the manufacturer is not happy with this at all. And I keep trying to tell the district, guys, you have to maintain a relationship with this company because all of your 30-year warranties are 5-year renewable warranties, and they just won't renew your warranties. You need to maintain a relationship with them, and so it's a very awkward, it's a genius marketing the 30-year warranty that has to be renewed every 5 years, because you can have that piece of paper with a 30 on top of it, and it looks really cool, and it's very impressive, but in the fine print, you have to renew it. What happens if the roof begins to fail? They just don't renew it. That does happen. Or if you stop working with that company and start using other companies, then they're not as interested.
Okay, we have to do a little bit of housekeeping. Assemblymember Arambola has a question, but we do have a quorum, so let's call the roll.
De La Torre?
Here.
Strickland? Arambola?
Here.
Berryhill? Here. Block? Buchanan?
Here.
Caballero? Fletcher? Huber?
Here.
Jones? Lowenthal? Perez?
Here.
The lines.
And another piece of housekeeping that I normally do at the beginning, but we didn't have a quorum at the beginning, is to always identify any cameras that are in the room. It's a policy that I've undertaken. Channel 13 CBS and Channel 3 NBC, just so that everybody knows who is here. Assemblymember Arambula.
Just a comment, Mr. Chairman. The information that we're hearing is quite egregious in terms of the price differential, and it's clear that millions could be saved by changing some practices. But to make it even worse or to compound it, I suspect that a number of these projects are funded with bond funding, and we will continue to pay the interest on those bonds probably long after some of these contracts expire. So we're paying good money up front, and we're paying to finance it over a long period of time for some very dubious projects. And I commend you and the staff for pursuing this. I think it has the potential to save some money that we can desperately reallocate to other areas.
Thank you very much. Assemblymember Valines.
Mr. Chair, I have to run to a meeting with Secretary Belcher, so I didn't know if we were taking recommendations, yes, what we were doing. I was just going to just follow up with Mr. Rambo's comments, and I think what you guys have put together in terms of the committee, but your leadership and everyone else, this is, you know, to be honest with you, I read through the materials yesterday, and, you know, I was kind of surprised. I thought, it can't be like this. Come on. I'm just floored by what's happening. And so I took some notes on a couple of the things I've heard that we should be looking at as potential opportunities. I guess we'll talk about that. And I just would make this general comment before I have to cut out, if we're not voting, otherwise it'll stay, is that, you know, we spend roughly $70 million in California on foster kids. We spend less than that on for the high-risk pool for those that cannot get insurance at all. And I'm not, you know, being a bleeding heart. I'm just saying that it's very interesting to me that we're talking about huge amounts of dollars just kind of going into the blogosphere. And at the same time, we have people who, you know, we have foster kids who can't connect with their sister or brother because they don't have money for a bus pass in town. And so, you know, I guess I would follow up with Ms. Strickland's comments that it really is critical that we do something. I mean, I'm not saying we have to act and do everything right now, but it's just amazing to me the amount of waste that's out there and even potential fraud that it's criminal at any time, but it's definitely criminal when you have situations where kids literally can't meet their siblings because they can't get a bus pass.
Thank you. I will open it up to thank you, panelists, for coming. Anybody in the audience wishing to speak on public comment? Seeing no one come forward, I'll close the audience portion. We have some potential recommendations. We have been given some new ones today that we just got today, so we will package those and distribute them to the members for a subsequent meeting. Did you have a comment on the request? Yes.
When I go through the recommendations, this is just giving you my thoughts. I think Allison's point on doing an audit, having the JLAC do an audit, is probably a good point in terms of, you know, we can move forward, not spend $500,000 on an audit, since we're all pretty much convinced that the system has to change.
Okay.
Your next potential legislation, I have to tell you, I'm a little bit skeptical in terms of involving the Division of State Architecture, and the reason I say that is because
the experience that was just cited.
Well, actually, I was presenting a bill, so I had to come back. But I mean, I've seen bin time taking 4 to 6 months on projects, and that's money, because that's inflation or not being able to take care of a good market or whatever. And I do think there are you know, situations that are unique to school districts, and the Department of State Architecture not getting things out quickly enough now, adding something to their workload, just doesn't make sense. But I do think it absolutely makes sense to have, I think, either disclosure or sign an affidavit or whatever, but that was brought up by several people, and we should know if there are any conflicts. Third recommendation, I don't know how, I mean, Allison and I had a sidebar, how we write this, whether you require, you know, three different specifications or whatever, I'm not sure that's reasonable, but I absolutely believe that we need a clarifying legislation that does not allow for proprietary specifications, either in terms of naming a product or defining that product in such a narrow way that the options are limited, and that we, again, and I know it's in law already, but that or like, I mean, it has to be there in terms of the bid specifications. So somehow having legislation that will eliminate the situation where only one company can respond, I think is absolutely necessary.
Okay. On the first one, the Division of State Architects, the idea was that we would have model specs that would be generic.
Right.
That maybe we would do it by geography, so that the issue that Assemblywoman Huber raised about places where it snows a lot, having specs for roofs.
You already have Field Act. You have a lot of specs like that. Some roofs, our district decided to go to metal roofs because of the 40 to 50 year life cycle. Some do composition, some do tar and gravel. I mean, even within a district, they can all be different. So I'm just skeptical I just question, and I could just be me, whether or not it can be done in such a way that we don't slow down the process, add extra work to DSA, extra work for school districts, and delay projects getting through in a timely manner. So that, because there are, like I said, there are plenty of specifications.
You're speaking to the review process, not to the model specs.
The project specification should be reviewed by DSA. If the district does its own design, then the project specification should be reviewed by DSA to ensure they are open and competitive. And DSA is not an entity that gets involved with the bidding process. It's an entity that reviews plans. They have three sets of approvals that go through. You have to have a structural engineer approve your designs. You have to have the fire, life, and safety sign off, and you have to have the ADA to make sure you meet all your accessibility requirements. But DSA...
And I understand the concern about them doing the review. I'm talking about the model specs, the generic model specs that would be off the shelf that a school district could go and take and say, all right, for a roofing project, this is what a model spec looks like that they could copy, as opposed to the review process.
If someone wants to check into it, if it can be, I'd like to hear from DSA before we give them that responsibility. But I also believe to have your second part of that, having DSA ensure that if someone doesn't use a model spec, because sometimes it doesn't work based on the type of building you're building and the land constraints or anything else, to have them go through another approval process, I just question what that's going to cost a district. Because if you have a $10 million project and you delay it 2 or 3 or 4 months, that could be over $1 million in just inflation costs.
The goal that we're going here is to know that someone's watching over. So I think if we're talking about somebody mentioned an 800 number, or who do you call when you see this is going on? And that's more what that point was for. So let us figure out, if we do an 800 number, who gets that call?
My goal is that hopefully we can write the law in such a way that we have as few whistleblowers as possible, because we're going out there, we're writing good specs, we're getting honest bid responses back, and we're saving the people as much money as possible.
Yes.
And that has to happen in terms of our requirements and how the bids are written.
Yeah.
The disclosure component was something that was raised.
I was just going to say, Mr. Chair, following up on it.
Yes.
We've heard today that the state architect doesn't necessarily follow what we're trying to ask them to do.
That example that we heard.
Right. I mean, so we have an example already. It's anecdotal, but it's true. So I'd be a little cautious of the same thing, not giving them too much authority. I'm not sure how I want to do it, so we can discuss it more. I think that's where you're going.
So let me do some generic recommendations, and then we will incorporate some of the things that were given to us today, and we'll come back at our subsequent meeting, which, by the way, will be July 7th. We are having a hearing. I know it's in July, but we are having a hearing because it has some budgetary implications. July 7th, it's a Wednesday morning, 9 a.m., same as always. So the first point on potential legislation was related to having some general specs, something that would be a model. Second would be, how do you report? How do you have some kind of oversight? Whether that's an 800 number, the concerns about DSA doing review are well taken. the disclosure of any monetary relationships, that was raised in the testimony today as well. And finally, something that gets to the specs that school districts are doing some minimum standards in terms of competitive bidding. Are those three characteristics something that folks are willing to go by? We will come back at our next meeting with some more detail as we incorporate what was given to us by folks today.
Can I just run through real quick? I'm hoping these things are included, what you said it sounds like they are. I'm not saying these are exact answers. We have to be careful, but we're going to take back and digest is what you're saying with staff. Number one is that we would have, you know, multiple bids or three bids as sort of policy and transparency. Open, transparent, and sign under penalty of perjury, which you've got in there, is number two, which makes sense. I don't know how we do this. We should think about some type of training. You know, if you actually do have public funds, you passed a bond, some kind of, if not training, at least a hearing for the oversight committee on bonds. Some, you know, just like we have, we get training from the lawyers who come in and say, because of these, you know, laws in the workplace, you have to sit down for an hour and listen to them. I mean, it seems to me to make sense to somehow get that in there.
And we would work with the California School Boards Association, right, or one of those entities, right, that already, right, does that. Or has those relationships.
And then I don't know, this could be opening a can of worms, but I mean, I do like what I heard earlier today, something about, and I'm sure there's some danger in limiting, but something about the people that actually approve these things should be engineers or architects or whoever is qualified, not necessarily sales reps. And I say that as a former person who used to do specs and was trying to get my business into that. I understand that. So, you know, it should be somebody that's an engineer or an architect or somebody qualified to actually sign off on these, you know, not a sales rep who writes their own business into it.
They're doing that now.
Yeah.
They're signing off on it.
Yeah.
You know.
So we will, with that general direction, be happy to entertain a motion on those.
I would so move.
Okay. A motion. And a second. Call the roll.
De La Torre.
Aye.
Strickland. Arambula.
Aye.
Berryhill.
Aye.
Block. Buchanan.
Aye.
Caballero. Fletcher. Huber. Jones. Lowenthal. Perez. Valines.
We will hold the roll open for another several minutes. Thank you all for coming today.
Thank you.
Appreciate your participation.